All I am is an officer's cook.
When I went in, I actually wanted to get in the paratroopers, and they told me politely that they had no Negro paratroopers. So I had to give up on that. I was looking for something that would give me some feeling of equality in the military service, and I didn't find it.
They didn't think that blacks had the mental capabilities to fight in combat, and of course, you know, that was all bogus, but that happened.
We didn't do any soldier business at all. We were assigned to the post laundry. So we washed clothes for the other. There was about 65,000 troops on that base, as I recall.
It was usual practice to put white officers in command of black battalions. More often than not, these officers were from the more racist southern states. Jaime Samuelson was just 20 years old.
The officers all were white, with the exception of the chaplain. The chaplain was colored. All of the enlisted men, about 1,200, were all blacks.
Against army regulations, Captain Jaime Samuelson kept a diary. By war's end, it would chart Jaime's changing relationship with his men and his views about race.
Very much depressed this evening, tired of these poor Negroes, tired of punishing them. I walk among them with a sick feeling. Hundreds of men sleeping on the ground. Most do not know the names of their tent mates. Many don't know where they are. Some don't care where they are or where they are going.
Officers were empowered to punish soldiers if they broke any of the army rules known as the Articles of War. For many of the young men who had just left home, the severity of the punishment was terrifying.
Then we had the reading of the Articles of War, and that was the saddest thing that I had ever heard. The sergeant would read, and when he get down to an article where it says, the punishment, you shall be shot, or whatever else, whatever other punishment the court martial may direct. And I just thought I would die. Guys were crying, and we had a lieutenant there, great big lieutenant with a 45 on his hip, and looked like every time they say you shall be shot, he would pull up his gun. And we had grown men crying and crying. We went back to the barracks, and I went in the bathroom and cried.
Black soldiers who had grown up experiencing injustice knew all too well how easy it was to be wrongly accused of a crime.
A word, oh, the rib, oh.
The black American soldier very often encountered racism even as they fought for their country. German POWs who were sent back to the United States were treated better than black American soldiers.
They could go into restaurants, be served, and sit there and eat. But we, in our best uniforms, we could not go and eat in those same restaurants. They would not serve us. They'd tell you you could carry it out, but they wouldn't serve you. So that's when I first started to get disenchanted with the military and with the army and with the country.
Millions of American soldiers were sent to the Pacific War Zone. Black engineering and quartermaster units accompanied the troops to set up camps and supply stations and to build new roads and airstrips. But before this, they had to survive weeks on the open seas in overcrowded ships.
I don't know where we were supposed to go in the beginning, but the islands kept falling and we kept changing courses. So finally we wound up in Bora Bora to rendezvous with a supply ship because we were running out of water and food and everything else. And then we headed from there to Australia.
There were 8-tiered bunks and I was on the 7th tier and I was sick as a dog. I was just, terrible. Seasickness is the worst. You know, you wish you were dead, you know. And I didn't want to throw up in the bed, you know, so I'd climb down, you know, and make it to the head as quickly as I could. And I couldn't eat anything. I just drank a little water, and I'd climb back up, and I'd just lay in the bed thinking, oh, God, when is this going to be over? In the bed, you know, so I'd climb down, you know, and make it to the head as quickly as I could. And I couldn't eat anything. I just drank a little water, and I'd climb back up, and I'd just lay in the bed thinking, oh, God, when is this going to be over?
There were some guys almost went out of their mind, you know. Everybody can't take that confinement and that stressfulness.
The Japanese army had victory after victory, taking islands and countries in Asia and the Pacific. When Singapore fell to the Japanese, America was forced to make Australia its base in the Pacific.
The general has been ordered to Australia by President Roosevelt to take command of Allied forces in the Southwest Pacific. His arrival in Melbourne thrills the free world.
Thousands of Americans were about to descend on Australia. The Australian Prime Minister, John Curtin, welcomed the white Americans, but vehemently opposed any black American troops being stationed in Australia.
Curtin comes out of the labour movement. He himself has very strong views about race, and of course he does not want black Americans coming into Australia because it's going to breach the White Australia policy.
The Immigration Act, the so-called White Australia policy, was the first act of Parliament passed in 1901, and it was introduced to protect Australian society from the corrupting influence of coloured races. Black American newspapers joked that the White Australia policy stopped black allies from entering the country but wouldn't stop the invading Japanese.
Our officers, I guess the army itself, had this alarm of segregation before we got there, you know. I never knew that Australia was lily white. It never crossed my mind.
When blacks were stationed in Europe and in the Pacific, they often encountered situations where whites were just given preferential treatment, or when they arrived in Australia, they were kept on the ship.
After weeks at sea, Captain Jaime Samuelson was preparing his restless men to finally step onto dry land.
Our equipment and clothing were all assembled, and we were ready to debark. Then came a message. The 96 and the 576 were not to get off the boat.
The black soldiers were kept cooped up on their ships while Prime Minister Curtin pressured the American government to respect the White Australia policy.
A lot of correspondence goes between his office and the American government saying, I will not accept these people, they cannot come here. But of course, they have to defer to the Americans who say, look, we want you as a base, we will bring whoever we like.